بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. So inshallah from today and for a few weeks we'll talk about أحكام الجنائز, the rules of the janazah and all the matters related to it inshallah تعالى. And we'll start with talking about seeking the cure, shifa, what is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of all of these things, to look at certain ahadith where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned about what we call it tadawi, seeking the cure inshaAllah ta'ala. So before we'll go through this, I'd like to mention that the death in itself mentioned many times in the Holy Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the believers that the death is a fact that no one can escape from it. And he said, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste the death. So no one on this earth will escape from the death. The death is the fact that everyone will taste it in one day, and no one can guarantee how long they will be on this in this earth. And if there is a person deserve to be on this earth for so long, there will be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. But we know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he died, passed away when he was 63 years old sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Holy Quran that the death is a fact, no one can escape it, and the best way is to die for a good cause if you can. Otherwise, you just submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and live your life as normal. So when the death is coming, it comes, and no one can make it less or more. إذا جاء أجلهم لا يستقدمون ساعة ولا يستأخرون. When the أجل, when the death comes, that you cannot make it more or less, because this is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, while we are talking about death, we're talking about the marad. Marad, when you are sick, when you are ill. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about this, about at least two prophets alayhim salatu wa salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about Ayyub alayhi salatu wa salam, and he was sick, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one who cured him after he made a sincere dua, Rabbi inni masani al-dur wa anta arhamur rahimin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said fastajabna lahu, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his dua and he cured him. And Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned while he's talking about the opponents and those who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about how he believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He mentioned that he is the one who created me and he's the one who can take my life. And if I am ill, then he's the only one who can give me cure. وَإِذَا مَرِدْتُ فَهُوَ يشفين. So when I am sick, the only one who can cure me is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here we'd like to differentiate between two things about the medicine and the shifa in itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us there are certain things that can give you the shifa, the cure. And he mentioned the Quran too. He mentioned the Quran, and he mentioned also the honey. And both of them, he mentioned the word shifa. And he said, وَنَزِّمَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاء. So we reveal from this Quran what will be cure. And definitely, the Holy Quran is a cure for physical and also psychological problems. And this being, many people, they suffered from different illnesses, and by the Quran, which we'll cover it إن شاء الله تعالى. الله سبحانه وتعالى gave them the شفاء. And the honey, Allah سبحانه وتعالى also spoke about it in Surah النحل, that comes from the bees, شراب فيه شفاء للناس. There is a liquid, there is the honey which comes from these bees, and in this honey there is شفاء, there is a cure for the people who are using it. And as we will see from a hadith in a minute, that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described this to a person and it worked. So as I said earlier, we need to differentiate between شفاء in itself and the medicine. الشفاء is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no doubt about this. And we know from our experience, your experience, you'll find two patients, maybe they are suffering from the same illness, and they will be treated with the same medicine. One of them will improve, the other one will not improve. This is a fact. Obviously, there are reasons for this, but الشفاء in itself, the cure is from Allah. No one can say, oh, this person, yes, because he took that medicine, he cured, and that one, because he didn't take that medicine, he's not cured. No. All this medicine that the people they are taking is a tool. But the real shifa is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islamically, when I am ill, should I seek medicine, find a cure, or shall I sit down and say, because the sickness from Allah and the shifa from Allah, so I sit there waiting for the shifa comes and that's it. All the scholars, all the schools of thoughts with one opinion that التداوي مباح, that to seek the cure, to take the medicine is something مباح, which is permissible, and there is many of the hadith which support this opinion. So the first hadith عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما أنزل الله داء إلا أنزل له شفاء. So النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام said there isn't any disease but there is a cure for it. Now we'd like to look at this hadith, the words of the hadith. What the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ما أنزل الله داء. So this means all these illnesses that we are suffering from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot ignore that fact. And because the marad, these illnesses from Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the one who also brought shifa to the people from this. Now you might find this shifa or you might not find it. And we know through the history, the people improved in finding different cure for different diseases. There used to be diseases. The people, they don't know how to deal with it. Someone will suffer from that illness few days, then that person will pass away. But now, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, you'll find there are medicine, there are people working on this, there is hospitals, and there is a big institute everywhere in the world who are working on these types of medicines. We have the medical medicines, which all of us, we have it in one way or another. There is herbal medicines that the people they are taking. There's alternative medicine that it is a science that the people they are learning in itself. All of this shows that, yes, as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, because all this that, all these illnesses, it has a cure, but the people, they need to find the cure. عن جابر رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال لكل داء دواء فإذا أصيب دواء الداء برئ بإذن الله عز وجل. He said, for every illness there is a cure. So when the cure managed to deal with that illness, then that person will be cured إن شاء الله تعالى. And this confirmed what I said earlier. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke about certain things that there will be شفاء in it. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أنه سمع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في الحبة السوداء شفاء من كل داء إلا السام. So أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى he said, I heard the Prophet ﷺ saying that in the black seeds there is a cure from everything except the death. And this is why, mashallah, you'll find these days many people, they are using the black seed and the oil of the black seed, and they are mixing it with other things, and it's working without a doubt, alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. وعن ابن بجينة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال احتجم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو محرم بلحي جمل في وسط رأسه. So ابن بجينة narrated رضي الله تعالى عنه that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم had cupping while he was in إحرام. So we don't know exactly what was the problem with the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم at that time, but he was in إحرام situation and he needs a cure. Then he done the cupping with the jaw of a camel at that time, and he said he used this in the middle of his head صلى الله عليه وسلم. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke about some things that we'll find on earth as well. عن سعيد بن زيد رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الكمأة من المن وماؤها شفاء للعين. He said الكمأة, which is this translated here, it is the truffle, which is a edible fungus. He said it is from the man, and the man is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the Jews who were, or the Bani Israel, when we were with Musa alayhi salam, that every day when they wake up they will find there's birds and there's a sweet comes on the trees, and they will go and pick it, and they lived on this for a while. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said this al-kam'a, which is, I've done a search about it, which is like the mushrooms, but the difference is that the mushrooms you can grow it, but this one you cannot grow it. It is comes by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and particularly it comes after rain and when there is thunder and lights. It will be on the earth about 10 to 15 centimeters, and in some countries they sell maybe the 1 kilo for more than 1500 pounds. And only certain people can differentiate it between al-kama and the other types of mushroom, because you know some of the mushrooms are poisoning. So there are certain people who can differentiate between this and that. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said al-kama, this product or this something that grow up is from al-man. And he said in the water of it, there is a cure for the eyes. Imam al-Nawawi, rahmatullah ta'ala alayh, he said, after he explained this hadith in his book, Sharh Sahih Muslim, he said, I knew one of the great sheikhs at that time, at his time. He believes in every single word that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and he brought this kam'a, and he squeezed it and brought the water from it, and he put it as eye drops. And that person was nearly going to lose his sight. And by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that person, he recovered his sight. Then he, Imam Nawawi, he said at the end of explanation, and this sheikh, this great scholar at his time, used to believe in every single word that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And this is something very important, brothers. Even Imam Al-Qayyim rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi, in his book about Madarij al-Salikin, he spoke about the cure of Al-Fatiha, how the Fatiha will be a cure. And definitely Al-Fatiha is a cure. I'll talk about this in a minute. He said for Al-Fatiha to be a cure, you need three things. First thing, the one who use it has to believe in it. Secondly, the one who use it, he must know how to use it. Thirdly, the one that you are using it for him to be cured must believe in what you are doing. And in the medicine world, we know that there are some medicines when the person who's patient take it with belief in or just imagining that this is working, it works with him. And there are people just take it for the sake of it and doesn't do anything. This is a fact. Al-Imam Al-Qayyim rahmatullah ta'ala alayhi mentioned this. And he mentioned using Al-Fatiha, he said, I tried this with Ma' Zamzam. I read Surah Al-Fatiha 7 times on Ma' Zamzam and I drank it and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured me. And personally, I tried this and it is working. Bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to read Surah Al-Fatiha on Ma' Zamzam 7 times with full belief that it is working and it works bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. عن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول التلبينة مجمة لفؤاد المريض تذهب بعض الحزن. عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها she said التلبينة which I'll explain it will cure the heart of the sick person and it will cure him from sadness. And there is now studies about التلبينة. What التلبينة? التلبينة, you need 3 things. You need barley seeds and milk and honey. So there's different ways of doing it. You need to ground the barley seeds and put them in a pot until they become bread. And then you put on them the water and the milk, and you keep stirring them until they are ready. Then you put the honey, and you wait until it is cold. Then you take it. Now there are studies that this is excellent cure for depression. That the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke about this 1400 years ago. Subhanallah al-Azim. And because when you look about all the ingredients, are natural ingredients. There is no chemical in this at all. Because the milk, the honey, obviously you need to bring a pure honey. And also the milk should be the milk which is not treated. And obviously, the barley seeds is barley seeds. You cannot do anything about them. So, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what he said, and this is, yani, when you look at the hadith, how Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who was living in the desert at that time, then moved to Al-Madina, he knows that this talbina will cure from depression. He said, تُذْهِبُ بَعْضَ الْحَزَنِ. It will cure you from some of the depression or some of the sadness. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that. And now there are studies, as I said, it proves that it works very well on the depression. And many people, they used it. And alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, by the will of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, they cured. So all these ahadith, brothers, telling us a fact that seeking the cure is recommended, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who created us. He knows what is the best for us. He knows that as a human being, we suffer from illnesses time after time. So there's a cure. In the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a man came. عن عوف بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال كنا نرقي في الجاهلية فقلنا يا رسول الله كيف ترى في ذلك؟ فقال اعرضوا علي رقاكم لا بأس بالرقى ما لم يكن فيه شرك. So عوف بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه he said in جاهلية we used to use الرقية Some people they call it تعويز. Obviously we don't accept the تعويز, but they used to do this. So they asked Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what do you think of this? He said, bring what you are using to me. So if what you are using there is no shirk in it, then it is acceptable. You can continue using it. Now, unfortunately, these days, and this is very sad, when you look at most of the ta'weez that the people using it, it is shirk. They are writing numbers. They are writing the Arabic from right to left, left to right. They mix the order of the ayahs of the Quran. They put words of shayateen, wal-iyadu billah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save all of us from all of that. Allahumma ameen. عن أسامة بن شريك رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: قالت الأعراب يا رسول الله ألا نتداوى؟ قال: نعم يا عباد الله، تداووا، فإن الله لم يضع داء إلا وضع له شفاء، أو قال دواء إلا داء واحدا. فقالوا يا رسول الله وما هو؟ قال: الهرم. So أسامة بن شريك رضي الله تعالى عنه related that the Bedouins asked the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم: shall we seek cure? The Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said yes. O servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tadawaw, seek the cure. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't put any disease, but there is a cure for it. Except one, they said, what's that, O Prophet of Allah? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-haram, when you become so old. عن جابر رضي الله عنه قال, كان لي خال يرقي من العقرب. فنهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الرقى. قال فأتاه فقال يا رسول الله إنك نهيت عن الرقى وأنا أرقي من العقرب. فقال من استطاع منكم أن ينفع أخاه فليفعل. جابر رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said, I used to have an uncle, he used to make ruqya from the scorpions. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he made a general statement and he said, don't use all these ruqyas. The reason, brothers, because the people is still not far from Jahiliyyah, and many of these ruqyas that the people they used at that time, it came from the Jahiliyyah, and some of these, what they call them, kohan, they used to subscribe it. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam doesn't want these people to be mixed with al-Jahiliyyah. So that man who used to make this ruqya, he came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said, O Prophet of Allah, I heard that you are forbidding this ruqya generally, but I can give ruqya from the scorpion. And the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, if you can benefit your brother, then they will do that. So Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم approved that this person has the ability of treating this problem. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, okay, use it, there is no problem. So what we can understand from this, if any person, he has the knowledge of how to do the ruqya, or any other tool that you can use to treat the patients, as long as you are able to do it, there is no shirk in it, then you can use it, inshallah ta'ala. Nabi Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله تعالى عنه قال جاء رجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إن أخي استطلق بطنه. So a man came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said, O Prophet of Allah, my brother has a diarrhea. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اسقه عسلا فسقى. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, give him honey. So that person gave him honey. So after he gave him honey, فَلَمْ يَزِدْهُ إِلَّا اسْتِطْلَاقًا. Instead of being cured because of the honey, his situation became worse. So he came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم three times, and the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم repeated, saying, اسْقِهِ عَسَلًا, give him honey. So in the fourth time, فَقَالَ اسْقِهِ عَسَلًا, فَقَالَ لَقَدْ سَقَيْتُهُ فَلَمْ يَزِدْهُ إِلَّا اسْتِطْلَاقًا. So the man, he said, yes, I gave him honey, but this makes his situation worse. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said صدق الله وكذب بطن أخيك اسقه عسلا. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said Allah is telling the truth. How we know this? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran that in the honey there is shifa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling this. He says صدق الله, Allah telling the truth. وكذب بطن أخيك, your brother Tommy is lying. This means there is something wrong. اسقه عسلا, give him honey again. And that person, he gave him honey again, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cured that person. So here we can see that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prescribed the honey to cure that person from a certain thing. وعن ابن شهاب قال أخبرني أبو سلمة وسعيد بن سيب أن أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه أخبرهما أنه سمع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في الحبة السوداء شفاء من كل داء إلا السام. قال ابن شهاب والسام الموت. And ابن شهاب he said that أبو سلمة and سعيد بن سيب told him that أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه told him that he heard the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم saying that in the Black Sea there is a cure from everything except the death. And they said Sam, the word Sam is the death. From all of these ahadiths, brothers, we can see that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged us to seek the medicine. And he mentioned here, he mentioned al-habba sawda, the black seed. He mentioned the honey. He mentioned the kama. And also he used al-hijama sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also he advised to use al-talbina. So this is when we are talking about some material things, which is we just mentioned. What about al-ruqya? Now, what I like to explain here, when you hear the word ruqya, what we consider ruqya, if the person who is using the ruqya only using Quran and Hadith, if that person using anything else, then this is not ruqya. If he start saying words from himself, this is not ruqya. It must be Quran and Hadith. Now, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sit for us certain ayahs for the ruqya? No. The Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't sit for us. They said, okay, you read this, you read Ayatul Kursi, you read this, Safat, Yasin, this. No, the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do that. But we have a general rule. What's the general rule? The general rule that reading the Quran is shifa. So the scholars, the righteous people, during the history of Islam, they found that reading certain surahs, when there is mention of the shifa, and if there is a person, he's affected by jinn or sihr, there is certain ayahs about sihr, and there is ayahs about al-hasad, the envy. So these scholars, Jazakumullah khairan, combined these ayahs from different parts of the Quran and started using this as ruqya. You might be cured by one surah, which I will explain in a minute. You might be cured by few surahs. You might be cured by one ayah. It depends on your situation. It depends, as I said earlier, on the one who is using this, and that person who is using the right method. And I'd like to advise you, if you go to someone, he considers himself Raqi, and after he asks you a few questions and say to you, could you please tell me the name of your mom? Leave that person straight away. Why? Because this means that person is dealing with jinn. And yani, seeking the jinn for shifa will bring the things more or worse and worse. And unfortunately, yani, many people from our community, they are using all these things. And some of them, they call abroad or they go abroad and ask someone there, send me. And then they put, as I said, the ta'weed, under your under the pillow or something. Sometimes they make you drink it or eat it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save all of us from that. So if someone saying to you, I can do ruqya, and he only read Quran, read authentic hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Receive it with full belief that it works. Because generally the ruqya, for the things which is not to do with physical, mostly, to do with something emotional, someone has depression, stress, or feel that he's not himself or herself. So believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Qadir, he has the full qudra, the full power to cure you, inshaAllah ta'ala. We mentioned earlier the hadith about Jabir, that he used to have his uncle who's doing the ruqya from the scorpion. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, you can do this as long as there is no shirk in it. So there is hadith on Abdul Aziz قال دخلت أنا وثابت على أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه فقال ثابت يا أبا حمزة اشتكيت فقال أنس ألا أرقيك برقية رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال بلى قال اللهم رب الناس مذهب الباس اشف وأنت الشافي لا شفاء لا شافي إلا أنت شفاء لا يغادر سقما. There's different words of this hadith. But this narrator, Abdul Aziz, he said, I went myself and Thabit on Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala. And Thabit, he said to Anas radiallahu ta'ala, you are suffering? He said, yes. And then Anas, he said, I will tell you the ruqya of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said these words, Allahumma rabban nas, مذهب الباس اشف وأنت الشافي لا شافي إلا أنت شفاء لا يغادر سقما. Oh Allah, the Lord of a human being, the one who will save the people, cure the people, اشف وأنت الشافي, give us شفاء, and you are the only one who can cure. There is no one can give cure except you. And this shifa, which will not leave any type of illness. There's another words of this. Allahumma rabban nas, adhib al-bas, ishfa anta shafi, la ishfa illa shfaak, shifa la yughadir saqama. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised that he said, when you are suffering, then put your right hand on the part that you are suffering from, and say Bismillah three times, then say this dua, Allahumma rabban nas, adhib al-bas, ishfa anta shafi, la shfa ula shfa, shfa la yaghadir saqama, and bi'idhnillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cure you. And we learn from this that the dua works, and the shfa is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now when there is a person, he is sick, and obviously sometimes when you are sick, you say certain words or certain sounds which tell the people around you that you really there is a pain. Is that permissible? That if I am sick, I say words to express that I am in pain? The imma, they said yes, it is permissible. And the proof of this, the hadith Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she is talking about the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, she said, wa ra'asah. Wa ra'asah is a word the people that they use to say when they have headache. Or even if they are ill, they say wa ra'asah. That means that my head is really, there is a lot of pain there. There is headache. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لو كان ذلك وأنا ذاك لو كان وأنا حي فأستغفر لك وأدعو لك. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يسأل عائشة, if this headache might cause death for you, as long as I am alive, then I will make istighfar for you and make dua for you. In another narration, also I will be part of those who are involved in all the steps of janazah. فقالت عائشة رضي الله عنها وعن أبيها واثق ليا. So when Aisha heard the Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم saying this, that he said, if you die, then don't worry, I will make istighfar for you and I will deal with the janazah and all of these things. He said, in a way, as a human being, said, in a way, what you are talking about? واثق ليا, يعني that she wish for destruction now. That الثكل means when you lose someone. والله إني لا أظنك تحب موتي. I think you might like that I am going to die. And ولو كان ذلك لظللت آخر يومك معرسا. And maybe at the beginning of the day you'll bury me, and at the end of the day you'll go to one of your wives. So this means that you are dealing with this matter very easily. You bury me in the morning, then you go with your wives in the evening. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بل أنا وراسه. Actually, I am the one who is suffering from headache. And that was the beginning of the days when النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم suffered. Then after that he passed away. He said بل أنا وراسه. Actually, I am the one who is saying وراسه, that I have headache. Now, these were the scholars. They said it is permissible to complain. And these are the words that they used at that time. Warasa, or some people say ah, or ah, or all these words, as long as you are not saying something haram, then it is permissible. Then he said, لقد هممت أو أردت أن أرسل أبي بكر وابنه وأحد. So I thought I will send to Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى and his son, and I will write for them a letter that he will be after me, Abu Bakr رضي الله تعالى. أن يقول القائلون أو يتمنى المتمنون. So and this will cut the wishes of some people that they will say, okay, we will take charge after the death of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then I said to myself, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not permit that the people will differ on Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. And also المؤمنون, they know the status and the importance of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. So I don't think they will do that. And so we can learn a few things here. The first thing, as I mentioned, that it is permissible to complain while you are sick, as long as you are not saying something haram. What's haram? Haram is when a person say, why me? Why everyone is okay, but I am sick, or saying, oh Allah, you lift all the people in Luton, for example, and I am the only one who's suffering from this, or start saying, what I've done, why I'm sick. No, to complain and ask why you are sick is haram, is wrong, because this is something beyond your abilities. No one choose to be sick. You'll find in the same house, especially in the winter here. This one is sneezing and you're suffering from cold, and the other, mashallah, they are fine. They are living in the same house, they are eating together. This doesn't mean that everyone should be suffering from cold. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he blessed one of you so they can take care of the other people. Just imagine everyone in the house, they are ill, and so no one can do anything, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala plan it in a way. And the other thing is, as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the other hadith, that while you are sick, This is kafara. Expiate your sins. As the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, even if there is a thorn, you know, comes to your feet or your hand or these things, and you suffer because of that, Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala will reward you for that. And he mentioned in another hadith that the second sin itself is one of mukaffirat al-dhunub. It is one of the ways of expiating the sins. So as a believer, when I am sick, I accept the fact that I am sick. And I say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. And as I said, there is no harm at all of yani, complaining, say, Warasa, oh, my headache. If someone asks you, Wallahi, there is pain in my stomach or my legs or in my teeth or something. There's no harm in this. But what's the haram? The haram when you start to complain about why you are sick or why it's me, why the other people, they are okay and I am like this. And here we can see that in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he mentioned that he's sick, and there is no harm in just telling that you are sick. Now, if you are sick, can you ask for death? All the scholars with the opinion that this is makruh. It is makruh to say, yani, if you feel yourself sick, you say, Allah, just take my soul. This is makruh. But if it is, the scholars, they said, if you feel that your life might be, or if you're still alive, this might put you in fitna, you might change your deen or something like this, then you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the death because of this, then this is permissible. And we have from the Quran, Maryam alayhi salam, she said, يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّهَ قَبْلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًّا. And Maryam, despite the fact that she knows that she didn't commit zina, she knows that what she is carrying is a prophet, but she was thinking about how she will face the people because she's a virgin, she's not married, and how she can explain to the people that she has a child. So when she imagined the people, and remember that she brought up in the masjid, what she will say? So she said, يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبْلِ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسِيَ مَسِيَ. I wish that I died before this happened and no one will remember me. And she made this dua because she thinks about the deen. Because the people will start saying how this lady who brought up in the masjid is having a baby outside the marriage. And also the people, they might start saying she committed zina. This is the reason why she said that. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم in a hadith عن أنس بن مالك لا يتمنى أن أحدكم الموت من ضر أصابه فإن كان لابد فاعلا فليقل اللهم أحيني ما كانت الحياة خيرا لي وتوفني إذا كانت الوفاة خيرا لي. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, don't wish the death because of any pain or any problem happen to you. If he'd like to say, then let him say the following: O Allah, make me alive as long that the life is better for me, and take my life if the death is better for me. So you are submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about your past, present, future. So you are saying, O Allah, if the life is better for me, then make me alive. If the death is better for me, then take my life. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam also in a hadith, he said, لن يدخل أحدا عمله الجنة. قال ولا أنت يا رسول الله؟ قال لا ولا أنا إلا أن يتغمدني الله بفضل ورحمة فسددوا وقاربوا ولا يتمني أن أحدكم الموت، إما محسنا فلعله أن يزداد خيرا، وإما مسيئا فلعله أن يستعتب. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, no one will enter the Jannah without the rahmah of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So العمل in itself will not make you enter Jannah. It is only a tool. They said, even you, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, yes, but I am looking for the rahmah of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So, سددوا وقاربوا. All the time be on the right direction. And don't wish death. Don't wish for death. So, the person either is a good person, محسنا. So, when he's alive more, this means that he will do more good deeds. And if he's doing evil things, this might be an opportunity for that person to make tawbah, and this illness will make the person come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know many people, not one or two, I've seen in my life, the death in itself for a family member or illness of that same person made the people come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah we'll stop here and we'll continue next week. Jazakumullahu khairan for listening. If there is any questions, please come forward.